Hello and a very warm welcome from the beautiful British Columbia for the third and final leg of the FEI Nations Cup, North America, Central America and Caribbean League here at the spectacular Thunderbird Show Park in Langley, Canada. Leg one in Ocala, Florida in February saw USA finish second, picking up 90 points, Canada third for 80 and Mexico fourth for 70. Wagons then rolled on to leg two in Copexpan in Mexico, and on home soil, the Mexican team were victorious, collecting a valuable 100 points with the USA second for 90 and Canada third for 80 points. The current standings at leg three here in Canada, United States of America at the top of the leaderboard, 180 points, with Mexico second, 170, Canada in third on 160 points. Five teams here make up the running order, and it is Canada, USA, Ireland and Mexico with two teams very tight at the top with points on offer here today. Well, the qualifying points, it is 100 points for a win. It's anyone's game here. Second 90, third 80 and so on down the board. Five teams, but only three of those will be collecting points here today.
For our young riders to be able to be in a position to walk with the team riders, the senior team riders, in preparation for their event tomorrow. I'm anticipating that it will be something that will really encourage them going forward. We talked about the technicalities of the course. We talked about the time allowed and how that factored into their performance and what it takes to be a team rider and what the expectations are for when you're representing your country as opposed to just representing your country.
Well, the crowds are building here for the third and final leg at the Thunderbird Horse Park. Great to have so many people here. And wherever you're watching around the world, a warm welcome to you. 20 riders coming forward, five teams. We'll bring you the start list very shortly, but a great atmosphere here in the T-Bird Horse Park. The ground conditions in the main arena, absolutely foot perfect. The team here have done a fabulous job. We've had a lot of rain over the last few days, but the arena really does hold its worth. And the riders I know, when they walked around earlier, really appreciate the amount of work that Chris Pack and his team have put into the not only the organizing of such a fabulous final leg of the Nations Cup here, but the ground for these horses, absolutely perfect. And Peter Holmes, who's designed this course, we'll hear a little bit more about him later on. We'll have a look around his course. Really has set a strong course for the final leg. Used to be very much a test of how horse and rider can jump, but they're big fences, but now it's changed a little bit, the sport, for agility and harmony with the horse and control with big fences too, don't get me wrong. 1.60 meters, some of the fences out there. We will have a wander around. As you can see, the stands, they're filling up. Great to have local support here in Langley. And the weather had been really kind to us today. Had heavy overnight rain. As we look towards the teams coming forward and drawn first last year, drawn first again this year, it is Canada. They'll be first out with United States of America going second, Ireland third, and then the first of the two Mexican teams in fourth and fifth respectively. Only three of those can qualify. Canada, United States and Mexico, and it's going to be right down to the wire with the qualifying scores. So Tiffany Foster will be first out for the Canadian team, followed by Heather Christo Williams for the United States, Daniel Coyle for Ireland, third out, Antonio Mora for Mexico, Mexico one, Mario Onyati will be fifth out, and then second rotation, Christopher Serby, Catherine Tyree, and Robert Blanchett for Ireland will be third of the, second in fact, of the Irish team, Patricia Pascal, and Luis Alejandro Placencia will be the last of the second team riders for Mexico. Kim White for Canada, third out. Adrienne Sternlicht for the United States. Andrew Bourns for Ireland. Federico Fernandez, Francisco Pascal. And then the last rotation, Ian Miller. Well, no better man to go last for Canada. And then Margie Goldstein-Engel, Connor Swell for Ireland, Eugenio Garza-Perez and Nicolas Pizarro will be the last of the 20 riders to jump in the third leg of the North American, Central American and Caribbean League here in Langley. Well, moments away from the first rider in the third leg of the Nations Cup, Peter Holmes, course designer, Canadian. Time allowed, 77 seconds. 12 jumping numbered fences, 15 jumping efforts, and the distance 509 meters. That time allowed will be very tight. It's a twisty track out there in the main Thunderbird Park. Peter Holmes starts them off over a vertical at 1 meter 45, turning right-handed to the Oxer at 2. And then we really start to get into the real guts of the course. 1 meter 55 at 3. And then a left-handed turn to a 150 square Oxer at 4. And then on 8 strides, it's a big forward 8 strides to the water jump, 4 meters wide at 5. And then one of the biggest fences on the course, the upright vertical at 6, 1 meter 60. That really will take some jumping. Left-handed turn to the treble. Going to be an influential fence, one stride and two strides between the first and second, and then two strides to the Oxer out, a long run down to the Oxer, the vertical rather, at 8 before a real turning question. And this will really catch some of the riders out, and I saw a lot of the riders scratching their heads coming towards the double at 10A, 10B, two fences left to jump. And it's the 155 uprights alongside the VIP area. And then that last fence, fence 12, and the finish, 150 square. And that will really take some jumping. 77 seconds, the time allowed. Every second over that will incur one time penalty. And it's going to be nip and tuck the whole way to the end. Five teams. 20 riders, Canada first out, USA second, Ireland third, Mexico one, fourth, and Mexico two, fifth. So the best three scores to count. There's the scoring system. Four penalties for every pull down, four penalties for a refusal, and that influential water fence, 4 meters wide at fence five. Well, if they get a toe in the water, it's four penalties. Elimination for a fall, two refusals, that incurs elimination as well, and exceeding the time limit, that's double the time allowed, that will be elimination as well. So we're getting ready to start with this final leg. The weather here, absolutely perfect, 19 degrees currently. We've had, as I said, heavy overnight rain, but the gods are with us at the moment. The clouds are staying away, the sun out, and a slight breeze. Really couldn't be any better, and looking glorious in the sunshine, the T-Bird Park here in Langley. Well, we chatted to Peter Holmes earlier, and he said he had to build a big track. It's going to be influential, There's a lot of tight twists and turns, some big uprights, and one of those fences he thought would be influential would be the upright at 6, 1.60 meters coming away from the water. They'll land pretty flat after the water, and then that inclination just to run on down fairly loosely to the upright at 6. That will take some riding, as too will the treble that follows at 7, A, B and C. Great shots of the water there. Comes early on in the course at fence 5. Not one of those fences that riders particularly like jumping. Not always a favourite, but adds a bit of an unknown variable into the mix and comes, as I said, very early on. Well, Tiff Foster, first to go. She will be riding Artisan Farms Brighton, 11-year-old gelding by Contendro. Tiff on home soil, great crowd here supporting her. Pan Am Games gold medal in Toronto last year, member of the London 2012 and the Rio 2016 Canadian Olympic team. Brighton, the winner of the Grand Prix in Antwerp, among many others. Very experienced rider to get us underway. Hope you're enjoying it wherever you're watching. Tiff Foster, first to go with Brighton, first member of the Canadian team. Couldn't really have a better rider to start us off. Very experienced team with the last to go, Ian Miller. So the clock starts, 77 seconds, remember. Tight turn from 1 to 2. Brighton, very experienced. A horse she thinks an awful lot of. Jumped in her first Nations Cup here last year. And she was actually first to go and jumped double clear in 2016. Well, there you see that difficult decision made. So that 1.60 meters upright at 6 as she turns around to the treble. Just fighting for his head as he left the water. One stride, two strides. Really jumping very well. Just gives the upright at 8 a bit of a rub. But it does stay in the cup. Remember, one fence down is 4 penalties to add. This a tight turn from 9 to 10, this double at 10. Really encourages the balance around the corner. Well, the time looking pretty tight. She may just pick up the odd time fault. She's going to have to ride. Well, she's going to pick up a time fault. And it is one for every 4 seconds over. So picking up one time penalty, Tiff Foster, but a great clear round. For our trailblazer in the final leg. Great support from the local crowd. Really is a favourite here. Very well respected amongst her peers as well. What a way to get this final leg off the ground. Just maybe took a few wider turns. It's a price you pay for a clear round. Just playing it safe in places. Well, Heather Caristo-Williams is the first of the riders from the United States of America. Qui vive de Songe Z, 11-year-old bay stallion by Caprice, owned by Holly and Ralph Caristo. Had this horse now for 5 years. This is a horse that Heather really thinks will be her next championship horse. Heather's first time here. And first Nations Cup together. She's ridden in now 3 Nations Cup. First of those. Ooh, well, a real mistake at 4. Now has to get the composure back to jump the water. Jumps well enough out over that, but what a shame. And has the upright. That is a very big upright. Stands 1.60 meters. Well, it is the stallion's first Nations Cup. She jumped on grass at Spruce Meadows doesn't always have the most opportunities to jump on grass. It's a different atmosphere here, and just maybe lost a bit of confidence. And Heather doing a great job now to ride him home. He'll learn from this, that's for sure. It's a very big dark plank at 11, and also has the last down over the time as well, 22 the total. Well, a real shame there for Heather Christo Williams and the 11-year-old. With Yves Desonges, 22 penalties they incur. Well, what a shame, as we just see that fourth fence again. Didn't quite get the stride that she would really have wanted off the corner. It's a very tight turn from 3 to 4. Gets a pat. He still looks fairly happy. Well, we move on to Ireland and Daniel Coyle. Daniel, well, been on flying form in recent times. The 11-year-old mare, Sita, owned by Sue and Ariel Grange. Daniel, just 22 years old, 58th in the world. Now rising over 2,000 ranking positions within 12 months. Made his Senior Nation Cup debut here last year, and jumped a fabulous double clear. He's had a fairly good show here so far as well. Daniel Coyle, based in Cheltenham, Ontario. This horse yesterday jumped a superb round. Very cool man under pressure. And he really does have a real hunger for this sport. Well, gets the 8 strides, and it is an 8 stride distance down there. And a fairly holding 6 strides to the vertical. This mare jumping out of her skin. Really gets in the air, explosive jump over the out part of the treble. So just turning to the 9th of 12 fences. This tight line to the double at 10, jumps in well. Oh, can't fault it so far, but I think the time again is going to be fairly tight. He might just make it. He needs to keep coming to the final fence. Well, he's going to do it. He jumped clear last year. He jumped another clear round. 1 second inside that time allowed. You can see the smile all over Daniel's face. This mare is certainly one for the future. One that he thinks an awful lot of as well. And a great way to get Ireland's campaign off the floor. And our first double clear of the first round so far. Just watch her through here. This double, she really tries. The back end kicks away. She doesn't want to touch a pole. Well, away from Ireland, we move on to the first of the two Mexican teams, and it's Antonio Mora with Galileo de Lawbury, 11-year-old gelding by Cardento. First rider for Mexico, one former World Equestrian Games team rider and Olympian, bronze medal at the 2011 Pan Am Games in Guadalajara. And this grey has some very good form on its cards already this season. The very newly appointed Stanley Van Pyschen, the chef de keep of the Mexicans, only stepped into the helm on Monday last week. Real responsibility, but he's put two teams together, fairly inexperienced teams. But as he said when I spoke to him yesterday, you've got to be in it to win it. They've got to get the experience. They've got some good horsepower as well. Horse really trying. wouldn't be the fastest of rounds. The last part of 10 goes, 10B, going to pick up some time faults along the way. 77 seconds time allowed. It is tight. Daniel Coyle just 1 second inside that time. So it's two fences down, eight jumping, one time penalty. A total nine. It is going to be difficult. We're in the first round and we've only had one double clear out of the first four riders. Just drifted slightly left in the double. And then the last goes as well. Flat counter stride down to the final fence. Well, now joining us in the arena, Mario Onyati with his own Coleman, first of the team riders for Mexico 2 Pan American rider, World Cup winner in California, two times national champion, and this horse was on the Global Champions Tour in 2015. Got some good mileage behind. A lovely jump over the water. It's funny. Oh, and then stay on, stay on, stay on. Well, what a recovery he is making. Well, well done to Mario Onyata. He made an amazing recovery. It's just talking about the water, there's a bit of a shadow on the landing stride, and as he took that first stride away from the water, just looked a little bit slow off the floor and didn't really get the six strides. And you can see just adjusting and never really got there, but what a job he did to stay in the saddle. That is not easy when you're that far up the neck either. He's just adjusting his tack. He'll carry on, I've no doubt. Mario, just making sure that all his reins are done up. Not sure whether he's got he's got the reins over the wrong side of the head. Daniela and shifter keep Stanny Van Pyschen is there watching on. Daniela, the team manager for Mexico. I wonder what he's going to do. Can he get his reins sorted out? No one's allowed to go in. He's undoing his reins to just try and get them back in order. But if outside assistance were to happen, oh, in fact, they've gone in. So the clock stopped, so the bell gone. I think that will be elimination for Mario Onyati. What a sad end to his first round. It is eliminated. Well, very sad, because the horse was jumping very well, but that's the name of the game sometimes. He will be back to fight another day, but that is his Nations Cup well and truly over. Didn't he do well to stay in the saddle? So we move on to the second rotation now. And for Canada, it is Christopher Serby. Christopher with Carnival, 12-year-old gelding, owned by Spruce Meadows. Competed in the Derby at Spruce Meadows. And did very well there. Second in the six par in Geneva. Of course, with an enormous scope. So after round one, it is Ireland leading on zero with that great clear round inside the time. Daniel Coyle, Canada in second with just one time penalty from Tiff Foster. Mexico one in third and USA in fourth. But very early days, it can change. Jumping that very very big 160 upright at 6 to the treble at 7. Concentration written all over this combination's fence. And it is really a test of horse and rider, a precision sport requiring ultimate focus and concentration. Tiff Foster watching on. Well, jumping really well, Carnival. Two fences left. Well, I think that's a very dark plank on the top of the 11th is a real question in itself. The sun's very bright, and as you walk up to that fence, you don't really see the top rail that clearly. And I'm just wondering whether on their way home, they just lose. They're right alongside the VIP area, and whether or not they'll just take their focus off for a second. So it is one fence down and one time penalty. So a total of 5 for Christopher Serby and Chela Corrada. Well, United States of America, it is Catherine Tyree and Bokai, 11-year-old Gray Gilding, Dutch bred. Owned by Mary and Joe Tyree, Catherine's parents, based in Chicago, Illinois. Double clear Wellington this year, second at Hits at Wellington for the Grand Prix and recipient of the Maxine Beard Award earlier this year. Very talented lady, and Bokai by Up to Date. Well, a real jumping machine. Making the water look very easy, 4 meters wide. And then on that very controlled distance to the upright at 6. Unfortunately, the upright at 8 goes. So 4 penalties carried. Very tight turn around the corner from 9 to 10. Bokai, just the last to jump. Time looking good. Just going to make that time. Very close to it, but 4 penalties to add. Well, that hopefully will drop the score of Heather Caristo Williams and Qui Vive des Songes Z 22. Top 3 scores, remember, are counted. It's very difficult to say who's going to be leading at the end of the first round, but the Irish certainly going very well at the moment. And it's now Ireland next to go with Robert Blanchett and Coupis. 10-year-old by Coupe de Coeur. Robert has had a very good season, had a great time at the Oaks this year, back in April. Had a good placings there, 2 seconds in the Grand Prix, and this horse previously hunted with Willie Leakey with the Blazers. Coupe de Coeur, sire of Coupis at 10 years old. Had a good look at the water, but no problems down to this upright. No trouble there either. Turning to the treble. Ooh, getting into all sorts of trouble in the treble. All 3 parts go. 12 penalties, 4 for each rail. Just as he came round the corner from the upright at 6, just looked like Coupis switched off momentarily. He then had to just give him a couple of reminders in the treble and said, come on, wake up, got a job to do here. Now looking a little bit more focused. And it cleared the last well over the time as well. So 12 jumping and one time, total of 13 for Robert Blanchett and Kupis. We just saw there Daniel Coyle and Michael Blake, the chef de keep of the Irish team, watching Robert's round. We'll just get a chance to see. I didn't quite get the turn around the corner, but just as he jumped the upright, you could just see the ears go back, and he just seemed to switch off for a second or two. But then got the act back together and came home really well.
Next to show on course for Mexico team number one, number 882, Babel. A 10-year-old
Well, Patricio Pascal and Babel, they are the second rider for Mexico 1, owned by Patricio himself, Chestnut Gelding, 10 years old, by Billy DeLis, two-time Nations Cup winner, started riding at 6 years old, Patricio. He has had a good career, and Babel was bred by Patricio himself, five-year-old champion, six-year-old champion, and seven-year-old champion in Mexico, and two-time Nation Cup winner with this horse. Now 10 years old, Mexican sport horse. Mexico one, currently sitting on 9 penalties. That's of Antonio Mora. And Stanley Van Pyschen, the chef to keep, watching. Ooh, just fighting his way down to the upright. That hits the floor. So 4 penalties so far for Patricio as they make their way back towards the finish. This double really is on a tight line, bit of a dog leg. Walk that distance from 9 to 10 on 7 strides. So just the last. And just inside the time, 11 one-hundredths inside the time. So just the 4 penalties to add. That useful score there for Patricio Pascal and Babel remained. Well, that will take them on to 4 penalties. Currently the drop score is Antonio Mora and Galileo de Lobri. 3 best scores to count as we come into the final rider in the second rotation for Mexico 2. And that will be Luis Alejandro da Ciencia with Salamera de la Nutria, 11-year-old chestnut mare by Diamant de Simili. By the family Placencia. 4 Nations Cup representations with Team Mexico. And of course, won the Mexico City Grand Prix last year. Very good jumping round that was. Really good job, really well ridden down from the water to the upright. She's quite a feisty mare, Salamera de la Nutria. Ah, well, pole goes Still a good round, and only the one double clear. When I say double clear, clear jumping, clear time, and that from Daniel Coyle. Tiffany Foster, our other clear, but picked up one time penalty. Plank goes to a funny line, just has a bit of a wriggle in the middle. Two fences down inside the time, 7/100ths of a second inside the time. So total of 8 for Luis Alejandro Plasencia. So after two rounds, it is Ireland on 0, Canada second on 1, third USA on 4, equal third in fact, Mexico 1 on 4 and Mexico 2 on 8. Well, now on to the third rotation. And the third rider out for Canada will be Kian White, 34 years old, riding for Freedom Z. Buy for Pleasure, 12-year-old bay gelding, owned by Anglestone Partners. Runs a thriving business at the Ontario-based Anglestone Farm. Kian himself was very keen as a young lad. Basketball and hockey, he played very well, highly influenced by Eric Lemays, and competed at the World Cup final in Omaha. So for Canada, Kian White for Freedom Z. This is where it starts to get really interesting now with the third rider, because we need to keep those scores as low as possible. And Canada now move on to 5 with one fence down. Just wondering whether the speed is quick enough as well. So spends a lot of time in the air for Freedom over his oxes. That will just waste a bit of time. He's already on 70 seconds. He's got two fences to jump. That goes as well. So currently on 8. He's going to get a time fault. So two fences down, 8 jumping, one time penalty, total of 9. That takes the Canadians now on to 6. Kian's score will be dropped. And Christopher Serby's score of 5 will be picked up, so they're on 6 points. We'll just watch him over the treble. Has the first part down, recovers well. Then this plank goes as well for the second of his fences. Well, next to jump, it is Adrian Steinlicht with Crystalline. 9-year-old bay mare by Cristallo, owned by Starlight Farms. Double clear at the World Cup qualifier earlier on in the year. Good jumping form already this year. Ooh, an enormous jump out over the water. And sits quite beautifully in balance, takes her time. And that is a real part of the art of riding. Real harmony with the horse and control. See, just getting a little bit argumentative as they continue their round. We thought the treble would be one of the biggest challenges on the course. It's certainly played its part so far. I'm can I just say that plank at 11 is taking its toll. This defense jumped very well. by Crystalline, and gives the back rail of the last to rub as well, well inside the time. That one of the quickest rounds we've seen so far. The chef de keep for the United States, Robert Ridland. So staying on four. Great clear round there for Adrian Sternlicht and Crystalline. Superb through all three elements of the treble. Really clever with her feet. Well, we move on to Ireland, and it is Andrew Bourns. Andrew riding CHS Inception. 9-year-old gelding, Irish sport horse by Clover Flush. Owned by Andrew Bourns Sport Horses Limited. Winner of the World Cup qualifier in Bromont. Second in the Nation Cup Spruce Meadows back in 2012. This horse competed in Ireland as a young horse. Oh, has a foot in the water. Well, that was very non-questionable. That was definitely a toe or two in the water. So that four penalties. It's always frustrating as a rider if you jump a clear round over the fences but then have a toe in the water. They can jump 1 meter 60 but can't jump the water. Still four, but frustrating. Lovely in and out of the double at 10. Well, the plank goes. That is the influential fence on this course, and one time fault as well. So eight jumping and one time. Total of nine penalties for Andrew Bourns, CHS Inception. Maybe we'll get another look at the water, but nine penalties sits Ireland. That drops them down the leaderboard slightly for the time being. We see the water. Gets a reminder on takeoff, but just dropping his head and neck, having a really good look into the water, Inception. That the second of their jumping penalties. And clear of the final fence. Real shame for Andrew Bourns, but 9 years old, and he'll certainly have learned from that. Well, the first team for Mexico, it's Federico Fernandez, and he rides Pegaso, 9-year-old Grey Stallion by Cassini. Holsteiner, two-time Grand Prix winner, two-time Nations Cup finalist, and also competed at the Pan American Games in 2015. That fence goes at fence four. Beautifully through the treble. Footwork is key in a combination like that, and really did show experience through there, but then just ran on down to the upright at eight. That fence at eight sits at 1 meter 60 as well. This is where Peter Holmes has been very clever. Opens the horses up through the treble and then on to a short distance down to a very big upright fence. The same with the water, opening them up and then short distance back to the upright at fence six. So Mexico, it is two fences down for Federico Fernandez, and two fences down and one time, total of nine. Pegaso, this 9 year old. So those scores ever changing. Mexico 1 now on 13, Mexico 2 on 8 with their third rider about to come into the arena. So Francisco Pascal, and he rides Manzano by Numero Uno, 9-year-old Bay Gelding. Jumped clear in the 135 last Sunday. World Cup qualifier first in Guadalajara. Nations Cup winners here, of course, last year here at Thunderbird Show Park. And also won the Grand Prix at Jalapa in 2016. This horse, I remember him jumping last year, and he rode a superb round. Another one to have a good look at the water, but I don't think he picked up any penalties there. The flag stays down. Real jumping machine, explosive in his technique. Oh, just doesn't get the stride down to the upright at eight. He's really trying this horse, Manzano. He jumps him out the saddle. Puff of the cheeks from Francisco. So currently on four, and he's going to collect time as well. Now just approaching 77 seconds. Spends a lot of time in the air, this horse. And quite a few wide lines, and it is two time penalties, so total of six. So after three riders, it's USA on four, Canada on six, Ireland on nine in third, Mexico one in fourth on 13, and Mexico two in fifth on 14. As we move in to the last few riders, the last rotation of riders, USA one, Canada two, Ireland three, Mexico one, four, and Mexico two, fifth. Well, Ian Miller, well, what can we say about this man? Ian, riding Sue and Ariel Grange's lovely, lovely 14-year-old. It is Dixon by Vigo da Souris, 70 years old now, known as Captain Canada. Began riding at the age of 10, six decades later, and 10 Olympics under his belt. That a world record so far. There's not much this man hasn't done. And he goes last for the Canadian team. Incredibly well respected, riding as well as I think I've ever seen him. But that distance from the treble to the upright just didn't come off, and one fence is had. That will count at the moment. He knows the time is tight as well. He's got two fences left to jump, and I think he'll be all right on time. Sees a lovely forward stride down to the last. So it is two fences down, eight penalties to add. That takes Canada on to 14, with only the one clear from the first rotation, that from Tiff Foster. She picked up one time penalty. She was the only clear round. Chris Serby on five, Ian Miller on eight, takes them on to 14. Well, from I'm going to be slightly cruel here, from one veteran to another, it's Now the turn of Margie. Margie Goldstein Engel, and she rides the final leg for Team United States with the 13-year-old stallion Royce. Margie, again, not a lot she hasn't done in her career. 10-time AGA Rider of the Year, competed in 2 Pan Am Games, 2 World Equestrian Games, and Olympic rider. And as hungry for the sport as ever. Not the tallest of jockeys. She's quite a small rider, but very, very effective in her riding. You won't see the horses really fight her on the way round. So really a really sympathetic way of riding these horses. Gets that distance down from the treble to from 7 to the upright at 8, 1.60 meters high. Absolutely right. And Royce really is trying. Time is looking fairly good. She needs to be jumping this under 70 seconds, this penultimate fence, just about there. And sees a good forward stride to the last and jumps it. Great last round there for the final rider from United States. That leaves them on 4 penalties. And we'll go to the top of the leaderboard at the moment. They dropped the score of Heather Caristo Williams and Cuvive de Saint-Jezy, 22-4 for Bokai. And Catherine Tyree, clear for Adrian Sternlich, and clear for Margie Goldstein Engel and Royce. Really impressive round, and the power in this horse's way of going and the ability he shows is just phenomenal. Gets a well-deserved pat. Well, it's really building into an exciting crescendo as into the arena for Ireland. Connor Swale. Connor riding Flower for Chinook Valley and himself. Chinook Valley and Connor, the owner of Flower, by Bonamy, 12-year-old bay mare, ranked 32 in the world, jumped his First Nations Cup back in 1997. That was in Linz, Austria. Formerly ridden very successfully by Nina Fagerstown. Connor just started showing her in January this year. Ooh, what a jump over the water. And unfortunately, that is one of the problems, an enormous jump, lack of then concentration on the strides away from the water. He did a good job to get her there anyway. But it's not a fence that the riders really favour, the water. It can be fairly influential. It certainly has been for a number of them so far. So three fences down now, in fact, 12 penalties. So that will be a counted score at the moment, but the time is going to be very tight. Now it won't be a counted score. That is 4 fences down and a time fold as well, total of 17. 16 jumping, 1 time, takes his score onto 17, and the Irish, well, they go on to a score of 22. Daniel Coyle, the only one to jump clear. Robert Blanchett, Coopers, his score will now count 13. And Andrew Bourne, CHS, Inception on 9. Total of 22 takes them into 5th place. With the last 2 riders in round 1 about to start. What a competition unfolding here in Langley for the final leg. leg three of the FEI Nations Cup, North America, Central America, and Caribbean League. It is now Mexico 1. And Eugenio Garza Perez, and he rides Victor Finn DHZ, youngest rider of Team Mexico, first in the Mexico international ranking currently. Very talented young rider. As an 8-year-old, his horse had a very good Grand Prix start, and Eugenio was under 25 champion, gold medal in 2013. I think two fences proving very influential on Peter Holmes' track. That upright at 6, 1 meter 60, and the upright at 8. That's fallen a fair few times, as well as the plank too. It's not been an easy first round for these riders. 5 teams came forward. 1 fence down and a time fault there for Eugenio Garza. So 5 penalties to add for Victor Finn DHZ. And that takes Mexico 1 onto a total of 18. Antonio Mora 9, Patricio Pascal 4, and Eugenio Garza Perez on 5. They go into 4th place currently with 1 left to jump. Well, clear rounds have certainly been fairly sparse in round 1. There will be a break before the 2nd round as we just wait for the last to go. We're in the arena waiting for the bell to go, and that will be Nicolas Pizarro. And Nicolas will be riding Timit Skeleptic. Say that again, very slowly, I think. Timit Skeleptic. This 10-year-old Baymer by Ballot de Rouet. Timit Skeleptic will get it right, finally. Already one fence down. Nicolas, a member of the team at the World Equestrian Games in Cannes, Normandy back in 2014, and a member of the Olympic team in London 2012. That fence hits the floor again at 6. Already carrying 3 fences, 4 fences down. Total of 16, now 20. Well, this will be the drop score for Mexico 2 for certain. In fact, it won't be a drop score because Mario Oñate was eliminated. It will be a counting score. I know a lot of the members were fairly nervous about their representation in the Nations Cup here, but they've done themselves proud. It was 6 fences down and a time penalty. So Mexico 2, 25 for Nicolas Pizarro. They finish on 39. So after the first round, it is USA 1 on 4 penalties. Canada 2nd on 14. 3rd, Mexico 1 on 18, and Ireland in 4th on 22. Mexico 2, 5th on 39. Well, 3 of the teams that could qualify for the final in Barcelona are at the top of the leaderboard. USA, Canada, and Mexico, they all stand a chance of qualifying, and only two teams can qualify for that final in Barcelona at the very beginning of October. Well, if it does stay like this, it looks like USA and Mexico will qualify on the point system. Remember, it is 100 points for first, 90 for second, and 80 for third. Short break here, but we'll keep things going. We've had our field reporter down at the collecting rink for the third leg of the Nations Cup here in Langley, and going to be joined very shortly by Kate Pedersen. Kate, who is reporter for TSN Toronto, very experienced in her line of field. Kate, you've been down in that collecting ring. What's the feeling down there?
It's exciting. It's thrilling because every team, their entire team, the grooms, the riders, the chef d'équipe, everyone is in that in-gate watching, cheering. So excited, so it's fantastic.
We've had very few clear rounds so far in the first round. We expected those teams to be there. I thought Ireland might have been closer to the top of that leaderboard, but it's been an influential track that Peter Holmes has created out there, and it's been tough.
It has been, and there were no big things that jumped out at me as we walked the course. It was just little subtle bits, decisions to make ahead of the water jump. I thought that might be an issue. The line afterwards up to a big vertical, and then we've seen number 8 come down over and over again, and that's, you know, a lot of focus on a very big technical triple combination and then having to whoa in 6 strides to make that fit.
Well, we've said that as they were going round, and it is influential, and I think where Peter Holmes has been very clever is he's designed those fences. He opens them up over the water, and then the strides down to this 1.60 vertical at fence 6. Again in the treble, they've got to be very clever with their feet, but then land for another holding 6 strides down to the 1.60 vertical at 8. Those fences have come down very, very easily, as has the plank at 11 as well.
It definitely has, and I think for some of these teams, we've been surprised by veteran versus the rookies. The rookies have really stepped up today, and that just goes to show, you know, the right preparation, a good horse, and being in the right mindset. But wow, what an exciting stage for them to be on and show that they have the poise and the ability to focus and block out all of these external pressures, the team pressure that they're certainly not used to, and be able to come in and put forth a clear round. Adrian Sternlicht, one of the younger riders in the field, and then Margie goes clear, and it's one that we kind of expect, right?
Absolutely.
But a little bit of trouble with the Canadian veterans as well that might be a bit of a surprise to some people.
Well, we're just watching a few of the rounds. Daniel Cole, we were just watching then, and the Mexicans, they've not gone. I mean, they've got two very new teams, and of course, with Stanny Van Pyschen as well. I mean, he only stepped in as chef de keep on Monday, right? I mean, what's the feeling in the Mexican camp?
They're very excited, but I think expectations are that especially for the number 2 team, that this is about gaining that experience. And as we look at some of the scores on that number 2 team, there are some very surprising quality, I wouldn't say surprising, but promising rounds, good confidence building for their team. And in terms of the chef d'équipe, yeah, he's trying to figure out who should do what. And I talked to him yesterday about who would go in what order, and he was still debating because he hasn't had a chance to really get to know some of the riders and the horses. So there's an added factor to that team that doesn't really impact some of the other teams like Canada, USA, and Ireland, who already know their chef and they've sort of got their routine down pat.
It's a really new experience, as you say, and it's one that he's taken on his shoulders. Daniela, she's down there as well, of course, team manager. She's there to help him and probably remind him of who they are sometimes.
You know what? It's funny you say that, but he did. You know, I flipped out my list and I said, okay, wait, these are the ones on team 1 and number 2, because with an alternate, he had 10 riders to be thinking about in that mix. We saw a fall yesterday that might have contributed to having one of those alternates step up. So yeah, it's a lot for him and for the team. I think the chef brings so much confidence, and there's a feeling of just not having to worry with the teams, especially with the Canadians and Chef Mark Laskin. He knows everything, he takes care of everything, and they don't have to worry about the external. They get their horse ready, they get themselves ready, and they come to the ring to win. And he takes care of the rest. So that unknown is just another added factor to be on your mind when you're getting ready for the show.
Now, you've been down there in the collecting ring. You've been interviewing some of the riders. How's the atmosphere? How's the feeling? How's the feel of the course been going so far?
I think everyone expected the time to be tight. So there are some riders that were very cognizant of it, and we see one time fault. You know, times in that 79
range. Tip Foster
range.
First to go, clear round. She jumped up with clear last year, of course. Jumped clear in the first, but just picked up that one time.
And they're all cognizant of it, and they know, and they knew that going in. But it's a balance, and that's where he said he would be sneaky in his course design. You know, there's nothing big like an oh my gosh fence that's going to be a challenge. And so that's where they've got to balance setting their horse up properly to jump clear, but then still being efficient enough. And that's where it takes a very perfect ride, smooth and efficient and accurate all around the course.
Well, it's a combination of balance and harmony between horse and rider, which they have to have from start to finish, the whole way around. We've seen quite a few horses fighting. You know, they do get quite feisty in there. They love their job, right?
They do. And the Scopey ones especially, they get excited when they jump a big jump and clear it. And with a crowd like this here today, it's fantastic, but it's loud. They're cheering after the combination. Meanwhile, the rider's trying to make that horse compact again to do the six strides into eight, and that's a problem area. So there's a lot of added factors at an event like this, this level, the team, the added pressure, and then the crowd. The crowd is fantastic. They're loud, they're excited too. So there's a lot to think about. But yeah, the horses love their jobs, yeah. And they're excited. And the riders can't exactly fist pump after the triple combination. So you see it come out in the personality of the horses.
Absolutely. It's difficult to feel the atmosphere in here up in the commentary box, but you're down, you're in the mix, you're in the hub of it. You say that the crowds, I mean, it's difficult. We can't even see from here how many, people we've got here, but it's getting exciting out there.
It is, and this is one of the most fantastic venues in the country. The VIP tent is huge. They take care of the sponsors, the special guests. It is a party down there. We are missing out because we're working up here. But it is a party, and I can't say it enough. The team camaraderie, we've seen it all week long. All of the teams have been going out for dinner. The young riders, the juniors and the children's will have a Nations Cup tomorrow. It's just a great opportunity for them to grow and develop, because we talk about the importance of the future of our sport. And I know the Mexican riders say there's lots of up-and-coming riders in Mexico. And over the past 5 years in international competition, the Mexican teams have become stronger and stronger. So for some of those countries that haven't always put forth a top-tier team, now they're growing. And it's all about developing those young riders. And this is a fantastic opportunity for them to walk the course, to watch and learn and really grow that sport.
And we saw that earlier when the Nations Cup teams were walking the course, that the young riders came out. And the Schefter keeps on walking the courses with the younger riders, that younger generation that are stepping through, and they are the future of the sport. And they're here, they're watching on the sidelines, they're watching a lot of their idols as well. I mean, what an experience for them.
It is, and for the Canadian fans on the ground, we spoke to an 11-year-old girl today who became friends with Tiffany Foster. Tiffany took her to see the horses, taught her a few things, gave her some tips for her own class. So I think, especially at a time like this when you've got these big teams, so many riders all in one place, these riders are great with the kids and with the fans. And so that's a bit more unique, because they're all in one place and they're all watching and they're all in the warm-up ring working. And it's a really neat experience for the kids to see and the fans to see when they're working together. And these are veteran riders who are used to doing it for themselves. So instead, Tiffany's going to be able to take the knowledge she gained in the first round and go to everyone else on her team and say, hey, you know what? I did this, but I think you could do it this way. And they're learning more about each other's horses, and it's a unique and a really exciting atmosphere for them, for both the riders, the horses, and the spectators to be able to watch a real Nations Cup, and one today with so much on the line.
Absolutely. I mean, it's anyone's game. It's going to get right down to the last last two riders, at least Mexican riders going, because Mexico currently sitting in third place, Mexico one, and any three of those teams, it is only two that go through to the final in Barcelona at the beginning of October, but anyone's game.
It is, and you know what? I sat with Kean White and we did the math. I'm not very good at math. I let him do it, and we have figured out that Canada needs to win, or if Canada comes second, USA or Mexico one needs to finish fifth. And whoever finishes fifth in that case is eliminated. So there's a lot of math, but Canada knows, and they are sitting there thinking, okay, what are we going to do to better ourselves for the second round? And one thing Tiffany did tell me was at the Pan Am Games, she had a terrible first round and came out and said, oh my gosh, you know, I've let my team down. There's that feeling of the team. And she said no one made her feel uncomfortable. They just picked her up and said, you know what, we've got to have a great second round. Drop the score, move on, next round. And that's what they did, and we know how well that finished for them.
Absolutely.
It's really quite interesting to watch the dynamic unfold down in the end gate.
Well, you'd say the dynamic is unfolding. It really is going to start unfolding for second round. And this is where the nerves will kick in, because now the pressure starts building, and we are really going to see those that can cope and those that can't. And it will really start unfolding now as we move into this second round. Is there anything, are the trainers, are the chef de keeps, are they changing anything? Have you heard any snippets down there yet?
Not really, other than I don't think we're going to see time faults in the second round. I've got to say that's one place where it's just so frustrating. The jumps you would think are the toughest part of the course, right? They're big, they're wide, they're set to the top standard, but they're having these time faults. So I think figuring out a plan, changing your plan a little bit to be more efficient on the track. I mean, there's not a lot of other problem spots other than the few fences that we've mentioned, one being eight that's coming down a lot, 11, as you said, coming home. I thought the water was going to be a bit more of a problem. It hasn't really been much of one, and I only thought that because it's a little bit of wiggling and winding until you get there. So you're not really on a big gallop, and sometimes it comes up as a surprise for some of these horses. We did see some quite explosive jumps over the water, but that number eight is tricky, and I know that these riders are competitive. They are students of the sport as well. And so they're going to be working to finesse any little mistakes that they made. And I think we will hopefully see eight come down a little bit less. And that's something that we'll see all of these riders working on tuning up between now and when they come back in.
And the other problem is, you say that we're going to see less time faults. But of course, if you then just increase the speed a little bit, you do then risk the chance of having a fence down. So do you play safe? Do you have one time fault, or do you push on and risk having a fence down?
That's where I think it comes into play. Where can they shave off some time and still keep them up? Can they take a bit more of a direct track? Maybe if they had to woe a lot in a 10 stride out of the water, maybe they're going to, into the water, maybe they're going to do nine and know that their horse is jumping well over the water. So it's quite technical in, as you said, like it's subtle ways. It's not a big area that they can shave much time off. So it's going to be efficient in the ends. Maybe an inside track to a different jump, and then we'll see a little bit of margin, and they can still focus without, you know, ranging that stride out and getting on too much of a gallop.
Well, I can't wait for second round to start. That starts at 5:15, and the five teams, they'll be back out, but currently it is USA at the top of the leaderboard on four penalties. Canada second, 14, with Mexico one in third on 18. Ireland fourth, 22, and Mexico two in fifth on 39. All still to play for. Kate, thank you very much for coming up to Sears. I know you've been doing lots down in the ingate and interviewing the riders. It's been great hearing your voice down there, and great having you up here. Sure we'll see a lot more of you. We're going to have a break for about 5 minutes now and rejoin the action at 5:15. Well, welcome back to the third and final leg of the FEI Nations Cup, North America, Central America and Caribbean League, leg 3 of 3, here at the Thunderbird Show Park in Langley, Canada. After round one, it is Mexico. In fact, after round one, it is USA at the top of the leaderboard on a total of four. In second, Canada on 14. Third, Mexico 1 on 18. Fourth is Ireland on 22. All still to play for. And the news we learn in the break is that Mexico 2, the team made up of Mario Oñate, Luis Alejandro Plasencia, Francisco Pascal and Nicolas Pizarro, they've retired. So we only have the four teams going through to the second round. And it will be the same order, USA, Canada, Ireland, and then Mexico 1 will be the fourth team to jump. Really exciting first round. We only had three clear rounds. Adrian Sternlicht, Margie Golsan-Engel, and of course Daniel Coyle. He jumped a fabulous clear round in the first round. So the order, Mario Oñate is on the board, but he was actually eliminated in the first round. Daniel Coyle will be first out for Ireland. Exciting young rider, Daniel. And looking down that leaderboard, we have 19 that will jump, and Margie Golsan-Engel will be last of the 19 on Royce. Well, that's the start list, and Peter Holmes has certainly put the cat amongst the pigeons in this final leg. He said he was going to build an influential track, and it certainly has been three clear rounds out of the 20 starters. As we take a look once more around that track, the first fence at fence one, an upright fence, 1 meter 45, a slight right-hand curve, to a 147, 148 back rail two, left-handed turn to the 155 upright, very upright fence at three before the FEI Oxa at four. 1 meter 50, the water jump at fence five, had a few toes in the water there, 4 meters wide, and then 1 meter 60, the upright at six, and that left-handed turn around the ferries to the treble at seven. 7A, one stride to B, two strides to the Oxa at C, and then they run down from the treble at 7 on five strides to a 1 meter 60 upright at 8, turning round right-handed to another Oxa at 9, and then a dogleg turn to 10A, 10B, 150 the square Oxa going in, 153 coming out, and then two fences sees them to the finish. 155, the plank at 11, and then running on five strides to the Oxa at 12, 1 meter 50 square. Well, the time allowed, 77 seconds. We saw a lot with time penalties in the first round, and the best three scores to count. We've had some drop scores in the first round, an influential, exciting second round. 20 degrees here, the sun is shining, the weather gods are with us. We're pleased you're with us wherever you're watching all around the world. This is round two of the third leg of the FEI Nations Cup here in Langley, Canada. First to go, Daniel Coyle jumped a superb clear round inside the time on CETA, owned by Susan and Ariel Grange. This 11-year-old Bay Mare gets second round underway. He jumped double clear in his first Nations Cup here last year. Will he do a repeat performance? Really exciting young man, and what a talent in the saddle. Going to the FEI Oxa. Into the water. And then runs on down, but gives it some air. The six strides. The water to the 1 meter 60 upright. His treble at seven, one stride. And then two, pushes for the two. He presses the buttons and really answering the questions. Gets a little bit close to the upright at eight, but no problems. Now these riders, they'll all know the time is tight. Peter Holmes, he wheeled the track and wheeled the tightest of lines. Needs to be jumping this plank under 70. Well, he's just about there. Will he make the time? Gets the five strides and inside the time. Just inside the time. 46/100th of a second. Double clear here last year. Double clear here again. Double clear, clear jumping, clear time. And what a round he's jumped for Ireland. Ireland stay on 22 currently. Of course, non-point scoring Ireland. In this North America, Central America and Caribbean League. What a round. Well, we move on to Mexico. Antonio Mora, Galileo de Lorbury. Galileo de Lorbury. And Antonio had two fences down and one time fault in the first round. He capitalised on that and go slightly better in the second. There's always a chance in the second round that the horses just get a little bit familiar with the course. They've jumped round once, they know where they're going. Ooh! Really stood off the FEI Oxa. Look at the water as well. And then that stride down from the water, it is on six strides. We've seen some go on the seven, on the slightly holding stride. And you just saw as he came out the water, a little bit of a bending line, catches the back rail, does very well to stay upright, and unfortunately can't get to the upright at eight. So it is another four penalties. Well, he's just going to have to get home now. We'll pick up a handful of time faults. Just labours in the air slightly over the Oxes, just hangs a little bit on the back rail. So that time already clocking up. And it clears the last. So it is a total of 21 there for Antonio Mora and Galileo de Lorbury. That score will count at the moment. Finished their first rounds with three counting scores. Antonio won of those. Very lucky. Clipping the back rail to stay on his feet.
Low-scoring Canadian from round one, just one time penalty for Tiffany. Let's see if she can go just
well. Just look at the crowds here. They're building all the time, and glorious sunshine for the locals. And one of the crowd favourites, it is Tiffany Foster. Tiffany with Brighton. Just picked up one time penalty in the first round. Lovely clear round. She'll have a slight change of tactics in this second round, I'm sure. Canada really wanting to qualify for the finals in Barcelona. Home nation.
It'll be just one moment here.
Tiffany,
just one moment.
Real Tiffany, local star. And just really warms to the crowd, just asking the arena party to check a fence, I think. Tory Brighton, owned by Artisan Farms and Tory Pines, Dutch horse, 11 years old. Just getting the back rail of that Oxer at 7C checked. Did come down quite heavily. What can Tiffany Foster do in the second round? Brighton is a great jumper, we know that. Tiffany, very experienced rider in the saddle as well. Only her second time here competing. Gets the 9 strides down to the water. And then it's this holding line. Again, we're going to see some on the 6, some on the 7. Depends just on how much they power out over the water. Very clever through the treble. You've got to watch the horse's feet through the treble because it's one of those fences. It's on 1 stride from 7A to 7B, 2 strides to 7C, and the footwork all so important. This is looking class. Ears pricked. 1 fence. The time is very, very good. And she jumps the last. The crowd go absolutely wild for Tiffany Foster and Brighton. That certainly has helped the Canadian team. 1 time fault in the first round. She wasn't making the same mistake again. And it was a really good time. Clear inside the time for Tiffany Foster and Brighton. So the Canadian team, they stay on 14 and stay, more importantly, at the top of the leaderboard. As we look forward to the final riders coming through the second round, this is where the nerves really start getting hold of the riders. We mentioned earlier as well that familiarity sometimes, as the saying goes, can breed contempt. They've jumped round once, they know where they're going, but Brighton was listening the whole way round. While Heather Caristo-Williams and Quviva Desange-Zy, 22 in the first round, wasn't the round they were looking for. This stallion competing in his first Nations Cup, 3rd Nations Cup for Heather. 3rd fence goes. It's quite a big fence at fence 3. A nice little skip across the water jump and then gets very close to the upright. It is on 6 strides. It walked on a good 6. But we've seen some just go on the 7 as well. There's a slight bending line through there, but all those curves, they just take seconds away, and that time very tight. Peter Holmes, the course designer, has left nothing to chance. If these riders want to jump clear and they want to go inside the time, they've got to ride the round of their life. Well, unfortunately, both parts of 10 fall, carrying 12. Well, improving on their first round inside the time. Schefter keeps, they would have been having a word. Mark Laskin for Canada, and the Schefter keep for USA, Robert Ridland. He will have had a word. Certainly had a word with Tiff Foster. She jumped clear inside the time, and inside the time again there for Heather Caristo-Williams. Quviva Desange-Zy. We'll see this stallion back. She thinks it's going to be a very, very good horse. He's still in early stages of his career. Well, it's Ireland. Ireland next to jump. Currently on 22 points, 22 penalties. Daniel Coyle, he jumped a fabulous clear round. Robert Blanchett now with Kupis. By Coupe de Coeur, 10-year-old. Picked up 13 in the first round. Just three fences down and one time penalty. Has Michael Blake had a word with the Irish as well? Blake, the chef de key for Team Ireland. The seven strides to the vertical, 1.60 meters high that stands. At six. Getting very close. He's going to have to do some work in here now to get out, and he works really hard. Got very close to the first part of the treble, and I have to say that Kupis is just turning himself inside out. Daniel Coyle there alongside Michael Blake. Time is not going to happen. This needs to be jump fence 11 in under 70 seconds. But could be a clear round. And it is. One time penalty, two time penalties for Robert Blanchett and Kupis. But well around, and he appreciates Kupis. He got him out of trouble a couple of times. Didn't see the stride he wanted all of the time, but improving. Three fences down in the first round and clear in the second. Just the two time penalties picked up. That will be a drop score for the time being, but I think we'll probably see that one being used. Ireland, of course, non-point scoring. It's Canada, USA and Mexico. Mexico 2, they retired, so we've only got the four teams in round 2. Well, in 2, the arena is second rider for Mexico. It is Patricio Pascal, picking up just the one fence down in the first round. And he rides Babel by Billy Delis, his 10-year-old. Not the easiest round in the first round. Rather fights for his head. Gets the eighth stride. And then just has to fight for the seventh. It's a decision the riders have to make very early on when they land after the water. Some land further out than others. Some land a little bit short. Then you have to, as a rider, say, okay, I have to go on the six long now, or the seven short. And this is where it is experience that conquers. Ooh, very nearly slips on the turn. The ground in the arena is absolutely fabulous, but that just unbalanced him on the turn, and unfortunately the pole goes. So it was four from the first round. If he can stay on at four, that will certainly help his causes. He's very quick and well inside that time allowed of 77 seconds. It was four from the first round, four from the second, punches the air with delight, and takes Mexico 1 on to a score of 22. They drop Antonio Mora's score of 21. Galileo de Lawbury. See him as he lands after the water. Lands short. Then makes the decision to take a pull. It was interesting. Away from the treble, down to this upright, again, just fighting as he goes down. Didn't give him the easiest ride in the first round, and certainly earned his biscuit for this evening as well. Well, Canada back into the arena. Christopher Serby. Christopher, who just picked up one fence down and a time penalty in the first round with Shella Corrada. This 15-year-old mare, Shella Corrada, really showed her worth, steps up the pace to the water. And the riders definitely respecting these uprights in the second round. They've learned from their mistakes in the first. They know where time can be saved. They know how this course is riding, and balloons out over the Oxer, making a really good shape. Certainly doesn't look like she's jumped the first round. Tiff Foster there. Tiff jumped two very good clear rounds with Brighton. Canadian team looking pretty good. And a five stride to the last inside the time. Well, what a job Mark Laskin has done talking to his team. Great round there from Christopher Serby. No jumping penalties, no time penalties. And he couldn't be more delighted. They stay on 14, they stay on top at the moment. One fence and one time, that's a real improvement from the first round from Chris. He'll be delighted with that. And why shouldn't he be? Shella Corrada jumped out of her skin. Well, Catherine Tyree now in with Bokai. In the first round, Catherine just had one fence down, riding under Robert Ridland, chef to keep for the United States. Bokai, owned by Mary Tyree, 11-year-old, this Dutch bred horse. Style of her own. She stays fairly low over the wither when she jumps a fence. Stays in position. Very good use of her body on the turn there from fence 9 to 10. Well, this is looking good. She's in the sight of that 70 seconds before she jumps the second last, and the last goes. Well, what a shame. Four penalties to add for Catherine Tyree and Bokai. They had four in the first round. The last fence goes, the front rail, it is four to add. Does drop the score of Heather Caristo-Williams and Quivive de Saint-Z at the moment. They're on 12, but takes USA onto a score of 8. Remember, in the first round, Adrian Sternlicht and Margie Goldstein-Engel, they jump clear, and they will be coming a little bit later on. At the moment, it's USA, Canada, Ireland, and Mexico. Well, next in to the international arena, it is Andrew Bourne's. Andrew for Ireland with CHS Inception. Two fences down and one time penalty in the first round. So can he jump a clear round in the second? Remember, didn't jump the water the last time, did exactly the same the second time as well. And has the fence down, shake of the head from Andrew. I think that's back to the drawing board. Not a water jumper by any means. I think CHS Inception would make a very good event horse the way he jumped that water. Little on this dogleg turn. It is a very tight turn to incredibly square, 1 meter 50 square Oxer. And that upright coming out, fence 10B, 153. And gets the five strides down to the last. Inside the time, this time much better this time for all of these riders. It is eight jumping penalties. Ireland dropped down one place with two riders from Mexico left to come, two from USA and two from Canada. Andrew Bourne's eight leaves Ireland on 24. While really hotting up. Only two teams can qualify at the moment. It's USA and Canada. It's incredible that Inception just doesn't want to clear the water. He did identical style of jumping in the first round. Gets halfway across and puts his feet down. Well, back to Mexico we go. And it's Federico Fernandez and Pegaso. Pegaso had two fences down and a time fault in the first round. Reminded once more that time allowed 77 seconds, and then you can already see the turn he's taken from 2 to 3, shaving off the seconds. Mexico want to qualify. Canada want to qualify, United States of America want to qualify, and it's all up for grabs. Looking fairly safe, but never over until it's over. USA out in front with a healthy margin. We've certainly seen things go wrong from any stage of competition. This second round, nerves will be getting to the riders, but I have to say as well that these riders are really taking on Peter Holmes's course. Doing a really good job. Stanley Van Pyschen has had the world on his shoulders. Well, the first part of 10 goes, so four penalties to add. Just the two to jump. The time looking much better. Well, Tank goes as well. In fact, one time penalty, so two jumping, one time. Daniela shakes her head, team manager for Team Mexico. So it was nine in the first round and nine in the second round for Federico Fernandez, Pegaso. Their score is 31 now. I have to say it doesn't look likely that Mexico will qualify for those finals in Barcelona at the beginning of October. It is fairly certain it's going to be USA and Canada. Well, Canada back in. Kean White. Kean was the drop score from the first round with For Freedom Z by For Pleasure. Two fences and one time penalty. Mark Laskin, Chef de Keith, certainly had a word with the first two riders in the Canadian team because they both jumped clear. Christopher Serby and Tiffany Foster clear inside the time. And if he can jump clear, that will certainly put a little bit of pressure on the United States. Never a surefire thing that these two teams will qualify. Anything can happen. But at the end of the day, you want to win. Lovely bit of riding from Kean through the treble. Gets the stride down to the upright. Very nervous looking connection down at the kiss and cry area. A, 10B, two fences left to jump. The time is going to be incredibly tight. He needs to get the five strides down here. He's not going to do it. And the last goes So it's four jumping, one time penalty, total of five for Kian White and for Freedom Z. He went for the steady clear round, but that last fence went. But it's still 14 for Team Canada, keeps them in second place. And we've got five riders left to jump.
Here's the first of two riders remaining to show for the United States of America, number 989 will be the next. This is Chris Deline and Adrian Sterling for Starlight Farms. Clear in the first, looking to go clear here in round number two for USA. Adrian Sterling, of course.
Well, it is Adrian Sternlich and Chris Deline into the arena. Jumped a fabulous clear round in the first round. Canada currently on eight penalties. In fact, USA for the United States. Adrian with Chris Deline jumped clear in the first round. 9-year-olds. Lovely balanced stride down to the upright as she turns to the treble. Never easy when a horse starts fighting on the turn, and it is quite twisty in the arena. But incredibly explosive jumping from Chris Deline. Doesn't look to be touching a fence. The shape this horse makes over a show jump is classic. Really tucks up the toes, bascules beautifully. Five strides to the last, and just picking up one time penalty. So that takes USA on to nine now. Maybe a drop score if Margie Goldstein-Engel can jump clear. But it is nine for United States. Really hotting up competition as we move into the final four riders. One for the United States, one for Canada, one for Ireland, and one for Mexico. Loves the job, Chris Deline. It is now for Ireland, the last to jump, Connor Swale, Connor with Vanessa Mannix and Connor in his own flower. Had an expensive round, it was the drop score in round one, picked up 17 penalties. This horse just lost a little bit of confidence in the first round, in the first part of the course, looking for eight strides. Exactly the same thing happened in the first round, but jumps the upright at six. That's that came down last time, and I have to say the Irish horses, they either clear it by miles or jump in it. Ooh, how did that horse jump that oxer? This is riding by the seats of your pants if I've ever seen it. Daniel Coyle, he can't believe it. I hope we get to see that in slow motion again, that oxer. How he made the back rail, I have no idea. Jumping out of his skin. He has two fences left to jump. The time is looking fairly good. He needs to jump this and move on the five strides. And to get the time, is he going to make the time? Oof. 18/100ths of a second over. He picks up one time penalty. But what a round for Connor Swale and Flower. 17 in the first round and one time fault in the second. That is a good round for Ireland. That's one for the future. Flower and Connor Swale, an incredible round.
riders last to show for Team Mexico.
Their total, 25. They're the first team to complete. Over the water, airborne. Now let's see this treble. Let's hope we've got the treble. First part, second part. Oh my goodness, the hind legs go in the middle. And he just turns himself inside out to make that back rail. What a superb clear round. We now have Eugenio Garza-Pretz and Victor Findy HZ, the final member of Mexico 1, picking up 5 in the first round, 4 jumping, 1 time. Goes on 9 strides down to the water. We've seen 8. Just the conservative 9. I still can't believe how Flower jumped through that treble. 1 stride, now 2. Yeah, lovely bit of riding down there, just adjusted the stride. But it's not an easy job for a chef to come in at such a late stage. He doesn't really know the riders. But getting to know them very quickly. Time, well, he's going to pick up a time, folks. But a clear round. Clear jumping, 1 time penalty for Mexico. They can finish, well, no worse than 4th. There are only 4 teams in it. Mexico 2, they retired. It looks like it's going to be USA and Canada going through, but let's not speculate to accumulate. It's not over till it's over. 2 left to go. What a competition set out here by Peter Holmes for the 3rd and final leg of the Nations Cup North America, Central America and Caribbean League. We're here in brilliant sunshine in the spectacular Thunderbird Show Park in Langley, Canada. So last to jump for Canada, it is Ian Miller Dixon, 4th team member for Canada. Had 2 fences down in the first round. Captain Canada, as he's known, 70 years old, 10 Olympic Games behind him, and that's a record in itself. Hugely respected amongst the riders, and what better man to have on your team. And he's great with the up-and-coming riders. Gives them all the advice and support they need. Chef to keep for Canada, Mark Laskin. Yeah, lovely, lovely bit of adjustable riding down there. Tiff Foster watches on with Kim White and Christina Serby. Ooh, very lucky at both parts of the double at 10. Just needs to jump the last. The time is very good. And it's a clear round for Canada. They stay on 14. We've just got 1 left to jump. Margie Goldstein Engel. But Ian Miller, Captain Canada, clear round. Clear round number 5 in the second round. They remain on 14. So clear round so far, Adrienne Sternlicht. She was clear but picked up 1 time. Tiff Foster, Christopher Serby, Ian Miller, 3 members of the Canadian team. They've jumped clear, as did Daniel Coyle. He jumped clear in his second round as well. Well, the very last to go in the second round of jumping here for the FEI Nations Cup. It is Margie Goldstein-Engel. Margie for United States of America with Royce, owned by Gladewinds Partners, 13-year-old Bay Stallion. She can have one fence down to still win, but no more. Royce in the last round jumped at a superb clear. We jump over the water. Ooh, goes on and has that fence down. Well, now USA are on 13. Canada are on 14. She needs to jump clear home for the United States to be victorious. If she has another fence down, it will be a Canadian victory. Two fences. Time is looking pretty good. One fence left to jump. And she jumps the last, inside the time allowed of 77 seconds. What a round there. Nail-biting to the end. Margie Goldstein-Engel and Royce finish on four penalties, and United States of America finish on 13. Well, excitement right to the end. It was never an open book. It was going to be tough. It was going to be difficult. But the results of the third leg of the Nations Cup, North America, Central America and Caribbean League, is USA on top. We'll bring you full results just as soon as we can. But what a show, what a performance from some really experienced riders and some of the rookies. They really showed their wealth in amongst a really experienced team. Peter Holmes, the course designer, well, what a course he set for the third and final leg. And that leg now complete here in Canada. They move on to the final in Barcelona in October, the very beginning of October. So book your places there. But the results of the FEI Nations Cup, North America, Central America and Caribbean, leg 3 of 3 here in Langley, Canada. United States of America, a win for them on 13 points. In second, Canada on 14. Third, Ireland on 25. And fourth, Mexico 1 on 32. Mexico 2, well, they finished in fifth. They didn't jump in the second round. They finished on 39 from their score from the first round. But a emphatic win for the United States of America. Top two teams qualify, and fortunately Mexico won. They didn't quite make it. It is United States of America qualifying and Canada. They go to the final in Barcelona at the beginning of October. Well, thank you very much for joining us wherever you've been watching all around the world for this, the FEI Nations Cup, North America, Central America and Caribbean League, here at the Thunderbird Show Park in Langley. We look very much forward to seeing you at those finals in October. From us all here at the Thunderbird Show Park, it's a huge and very warm thank you and goodbye.